Let's go ahead and look at John chapter 3 one more time. Same passages of scripture I quoted to you in the last video. Verse number 4, Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus said, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. I don't know about you, but I am an animal lover. I have been for many, many years, the majority of my life. My favorite animal is the dog. I love dogs. We've had a dog for as many years as I can remember. Some of the best dogs that I was tremendous friends with. They were tremendous companions. And nothing but good memories. Obviously, though, as time goes on, and unfortunately, in the brevity of their lifespan, they pass on, they grow old, they lose their strength, unfortunately under the curse of sin, and they die. In my brief 3 decades or so on earth, I've had to say goodbye already to some very, very good friends of mine that were dogs and such good companions. I miss them. Just recently, we had to say goodbye to a little dog that we had. We had to take it to the vet, and he had to peacefully send him away. And recently, unfortunately, there was an accident with a sibling of mine. She lost one of her pets. It was the pet went down wandering by the roadside. And it was strayed away from home a little bit, and it was involved in an accident on the road where driver didn't see it. It wasn't their fault, I don't think. Things like that just happen. You know, you look on the highway, there's deer laying everywhere, depending on where you live. And just things happen. And I don't think anybody intended for that to happen, but it was very unfortunate and very sad. And she lost a pet and a companion that meant a lot to her in that accident. And I'm sure some of you, many of you, share the same story. We love our friends that God gives to us from the animal kingdom. We love them. I love animals, like I've said. Now, of course, I don't let that love and affection drift into extremism wherein I prioritize animals above my fellow human beings. I don't go into the insanity of veganism or vegetarianism or whatever. I understand how God has designated the purpose of the animal and the sacrificial necessity of this world, and how he has given them and cleansed them for our strength and our nourishment, physically speaking. Is veganism biblical? Absolutely not. As a matter of fact, it is a sign that we are living in the last days, the rise of it. It is rooted in Eastern religions that came to the United States of America. And as Adrian Rogers well pointed out, that they knew they could not pervade our Bible-saturated society with their strange ideas, so they dressed it up as humanitarian things. Don't kill the cattle was essentially what they came and cloaked their religions in, and then were able to pervade and penetrate our common sense with insanity. Paul said in the last days there would be teachers coming, commanding to abstain from meats which God has given to be received with thanksgiving. For every creature is good and is not to be denied or turned away. God has given them for us to consume for our physical strength. Unfortunately, just as he gave the animal to be the sacrifice temporarily for our sin, although it could not take away, God has given the animal to be sacrificed for our consumption for physical strength. I know it seems barbaric, it seems wrong, but my friend, that is God, the Creator, gaining purpose out of their death, as I've explained before. The animal is going to die either way, and they'll die and lay in the forest and be consumed by another beast or another vulture. Or God has given them to be sacrificed for our sustenance. and our strength. And that way he gains purpose out of their death, just as we are all dying for something. And God has told us to take up our cross and perform our reasonable service. So the animal, also under the curse of death, is dying. And they'll kill one another, eat one another, or God will say, go hunt them down. Hunting is not wrong. It's not wrong to hunt and gather. It is scriptural. God told Peter, don't call uncommon what I have called common. Some of you say he wasn't speaking about animals there. Well, God never reveals or relates anything, even in a parable, that isn't true, because he cannot lie. So if he's not speaking about animals, if it's not wrong to kill and eat, he wouldn't have used that as an illustration either way, because then it would be wrong. If he says, rise, kill, and eat, and uses an illustration with animals, that means that is justified regardless. Just like the Jehovah's Witness say, when Jesus was speaking of hell, he wasn't speaking of hell. No, if hell isn't real and if it's just a parable, he doesn't use it as a parable, because he only uses it as a parable if it's a fact and if it's a truth and reality. Even if Jesus wasn't literally, or the Spirit of God wasn't literally telling Peter, kill and eat animals in that vision, He couldn't use that as an illustration if it wasn't a fact and a reality. He used it because it is a reality. God has cleansed, Paul said. What God has called common, let no man call uncommon. Every creature of God is good and to be received with thanksgiving. I love you, my friend. And I have friends that are vegan or whatever. I don't really talk to them about it. But this is the truth of the Word of God. And in the last days, Paul said, there will come false teachers commanding you to abstain from meats. The popularity of veganism globally has nothing more to do with anything than the fact that we're living in the last days and Jesus Christ is coming back. Should you feel guilty about eating meat? Absolutely not. God has given it because you need what they have to supply for your physical sustenance and strength. God has given it to be sacrificially taken and consumed for your strength. It's not a sin to eat meat. It's not a sin to eat meat. It is not a sin. God ate meat with Abraham. Jesus fished and ate fish, and he ate every kind of meat known to man when he walked on earth. It's not a sin. It is not a sin. They'll eat one another. They'll lay down, die, and rot, and gain no purpose out of their life, much less their death. As God has called us to gain a purpose for eternity for those around us out of our life and our death, so he has designated a purpose to the animal. And that is that they, sacrificially, many of them, in the appropriate time, in the time of God, in their short lifespan, give themselves for our strength. We need them to live. If you don't include meat in your life, and I understand there's some people who have Lyme's disease or whatever, they cannot consume certain meats, but the majority of us need meat to live and survive. We need that sustenance. We need that substitutionary, supplementary aspect to our internal organs. We need meat for meat, protein. And if you don't have that in your diet, you're going to be sickly and you're going to be given to certain things. It is a necessity, unfortunately, in this cruel world, in this cruel and evil world, it is a necessity. We must have it to be strong, and God has given it. And when you reject it for your own carnal thinking because of the lies of hell, you're doing nothing more than making yourself weak and offending God for what he has given to be received with thanksgiving. Pray over your food. Thank God for it. But don't think you're doing something for God and planet Earth by not eating meat. You're not. You're just a part of something that the devil has raised up. And I know that it sounds offensive. It really doesn't matter in the grand scheme of things. If you want to be a vegetarian, go for it. But biblically, scripturally, it's not sound. It's not so. And I don't know if I have the heart to hunt down an animal and kill him as much as I love him, but I understand the necessity. And if I could, I would, and I will. And I'm not advocating for animal cruelty in any of this. I think when it comes to the slaughter and sacrifice of animals for our natural provision and sustenance, we need to do so in the most ethical way possible and afford them the least amount of suffering. The Bible says a righteous man considers the life of his beast, but the wicked are cruel. We should care for our pets. We should care for the animals around us the best that we can. Not above humanity. Not above fellow humanity. But we should do our best to care for them. And when it comes to the sacrifice of them for our consumption, we should do so in the most ethical way possible. possible a righteous man considers the life of his beast. But I love them just the same, and I am an animal lover, and I love dogs most of all. They're my favorite. I love cats also, but not as much, because cats are they're definitely not as loving as dogs are. And I've had many, many good dogs on Earth, and unfortunately I've had to say goodbye to them. And every time that has happened, even recently, even with this accident my sibling endured a short while ago, the question has arisen if by nothing else a statement made by the individual who has had to say goodbye to their dear friend, the pet. Well, at least I'll see them in heaven, they say. Or, thank God, my pet is now in heaven. And as we spoke of those dearly departed unborn children or miscarried children or even youth among us that were taken from us prematurely, where are they now? Has God taken them to heaven? Where are they now? What about our pets? And what about the animals around us? What about all of them? Is there a place in heaven even for the animal? Where are they? Where is your beloved pet that passed away? Did they go to heaven? Did they go to hell? Do they even go anywhere? Well, I'm going to try to answer that question for you today. We talked about the unborn babies. Do they go to heaven? Well, let's talk about our animal friends. Do they go to heaven? Do they go to hell? Do they go anywhere? What happens to the animal that dies? Let's consider the word of Jesus Christ here in John chapter 3. He said, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Now let's understand one thing. Everything of planet Earth is cursed. And everything of planet Earth is slated for damnation and destruction by fire of God Almighty. And the very simple fact of the matter is the only way out of that curse and that destruction is the Lord Jesus Christ. And except you be born again and brought into Him, in some way, shape, or form, redeemed by His blood in some way, you cannot and will not escape the curse, the damnation, and the demolition that planet Earth is scheduled for. Jesus said, except a man, that's a human being, be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. So the qualification clearly stated and slated by the Lord Jesus Christ to make it to heaven, number one, it's for human beings, salvation, regeneration. A man. He's speaking of the human race. God came to redeem man. Let's make that very clear. God came to redeem man, not the animals. And He gave the animals even as a part for our redemption. Except a man be born of water, you must be a human being that was born, and regeneration, redemption is offered for you and you seemingly alone. And then you must be a human being that's born again. I love the animals, but God did not primarily come to save them. God came to save you and me. Salvation is exclusive to the human race. He speaks of spirit beings, and He speaks of the human beings of this planet who must be born again to make it out of this world and make it to heaven. As much as I love my furry friends, salvation, regeneration was not and is not primarily for them, except a man be born again, being born of water. And by the way, He's not speaking of water baptism. Ask the lady who's pregnant, very, very pregnant, what happens? Her water breaks and that water pushes the child out of her body. Except a man be born of water. That was terminology, is historic scientific terminology for your natural birth. Born of water. My goodness, her water broke. Here comes the child. And then born of the Spirit, born within, created new by the Spirit of God, made brand new, created brand new, born again, taken out of Adam, put into Christ. Salvation is indeed absolutely no doubt about it for humanity. For God so loved the world that whosoever believes on His Son, He gave His only begotten Son, whosoever believes in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. As much as I love animals, it's not primarily for animals. It's for those of us created in the image of God, made in the image of God. Jesus came to die for you. He came to die for me. Human beings, they are God's priority. That's why God has given the animal, first of all, to be sacrificed to cover our sins so He would not have to kill us. And then now to be sacrificed for our physical strength so we don't die prematurely with diabetes and everything else. God gave them. God gave them. Why? Because we are above Him. And if you are prioritizing animals above human beings, my friend, with all due respect, with all kindness, you've got problems. If you care more about dying polar bears in the middle of the Arctic than you do these dying, aborting babies or this human trafficking epidemic, you've got problems, my friend. Something's wrong with you. You're lacking natural affection, another sign of the last days. Something's wrong with you. If you care more about bald eagle eggs than you do about little babies all over this world that are being killed in their mother's womb, or the children that are hungry and starving all over planet Earth, with all due respect, my friend, something is wrong with you. If you're exerting more time and energy to fight to stop these factories from making hot dogs than you do to stop drag queens from indoctrinating innocent children, something's wrong with you, my friend. If you care more about animals than you do those in the hospitals, those being gunned down in Chicago, those being murdered and maimed all over this world, the handicapped, if you care more about animals, something's wrong with you, and you're lacking something that's as natural as the air you breathe. I love animals. Yes, I do. I'm an animal lover. But I'm not going to put them above my primary responsibility to my God and my fellow man. And neither has God. Salvation primarily is for the human being made in the image of God. You need to understand the worth of your soul and every soul around you. The animal, compared to us, is worthless, even though they have worth and value. God gave the animal, God created the animal for us to be a servant to us in one aspect, to be a companion to us, to provide for us, and that's what they do. There's some animals like they're like a walk-in refrigerator. The heart that God gave them keeps that meat fresh, keeps producing that milk, etc., etc. Provision. I'm not trying to be gruesome. I know that offends those of you who are vegan and vegetarian. I'm sorry, guys, you're not seeing it right. Something's wrong. You're not seeing it correctly. The affections of your heart are misguided. There's a priority crisis in your life. Once you understand the value of your human man, your fellow human being, you may well understand the value of animals and compare. And as much as I love them, yes, I do. As much of a heart as I have for them, I'll still not put them above myself or my fellow man, and I won't reject what God has given. Rise, Peter, kill and eat. Don't call what I've given uncommon. Peter said, I'm not going to eat that because I've never eaten anything that's unclean. God said, I've cleansed it all. You can have it all. Paul said, every creature of God is good and to be taken with thanksgiving. God did not send His Son to redeem animals. God gave animals to cover our sin and sacrifice. God has given animals to provide for us provision of natural strength and sacrifice. God gave His only begotten Son to die on the cross for you and for me, not the animal. However, that being stated, that being understood, that being considered, let us also balance this truth by saying that God also loves the animals, and they, as we are a creation of God, are a creation of God. I want to read a scripture verse to you. Psalm chapter 36, verse 6. I was speaking to my mother, strangely enough, about this topic. Do all dogs go to heaven? What happens to our dogs when they die? And I happened across a Mark Lowry video. And Mark Lowry is wearing a t-shirt that said Psalm 36, 6, dogs go to heaven. Mark Lowry. So I give Mark Lowry credit for pointing me in this direction of this verse. Right when we were talking about that topic. Divine timing. Psalm 36, 6, the Word of God says this, Thy righteousness, God's righteousness, is like the mountains. Thy judgments are a great deep. O Lord, Thou preservest man and beast. The next verse goes on to say, How excellent is Thy loving kindness. Listen to this again. Thou preservest man and beast, O Lord. God doesn't just seek to redeem man, God seeks to redeem the animal. What a profound statement. You think about what God did, and then God took me from this scripture verse, He took me to the great flood that He was going to send on earth. And what did God do? Not only did He save Noah and his sons and daughters, God told Noah, you get two of every kind of animal. Bring them into the ark. Bring them into the ark. A covenant God made with Noah. Bring the animals too, to save them. You think about Jonah. God sent it to Nineveh, a city slated for destruction. Jonah was pouting over the fact that God saved them, and God told Jonah, shouldn't I save them? They have thousands of souls in there, not to mention thousands of animals. The psalmist said, O Lord, thou preservest man and beast. Think about the traditional ways of God, the nature of God, the character of God that not only considers man and saves man, prioritizes man, but also contained in that, in the background. God has historically, traditionally also considered and preserved the animal. Amazing. Amazing love. You know, because as much as He took His time and created us in His image, He also created them. They mean something to Him too. Are they God's priority? No. Are they God's primary concern? No. Did Jesus die primarily for them? No. But Lord, You preserve man and beast. Somewhere contained in the new covenant, there is a clause in that contract that has also secured and assured and provided salvation for animals. Some way, somehow. The Bible says His eye is on the sparrow. The Bible said He provides for the birds. They don't ask where my food's coming from. They just go out and get it. And if God has to get a gentle, kind, elderly woman to go by a side of a lake and throw out a bag of Wonder Bread to a flock of ducks, God will provide for them. If he gets a worm to come out of the ground at the right time, God will provide for them. If He has another animal fall in the right place at the right time, God will provide for them. He provides for the animals even. He considers them even. Because He loves them as He loves us, not as much as He loves us, but He cares for them also. If He cares for the sparrow, wouldn't He save them also? Lord, Thou preservest man and beast. God saves us by the cross of His Son, but guess what? God also saves the beast, the animal. What happens to your animal that passed away, your pet that you love so much? Is there a way they go to heaven? Yes. I think it's a complicated answer, though, and I want to try with God's help to answer the best that I can. Animals, unlike us, are not spirit beings. They are just natural beings. They just have a body. You and I, human beings, are body, soul, spirit. So animals, so to speak, are only born of water. They cannot be born again, regenerated on the inside. But God in heaven has a perfect record of every creature that He has created. He knows them. He knows where they are, or even if they've gone to ashes. For many decades, centuries, millennia to this point, He knows exactly who they were, who they are. There can be no way, given that they are not spirit beings, unless the Creator would bring their existence up there, because they existed, but not eternally. They're not created in the image of God like we are, so they're not eternal spirit beings. So when your pet dies, and it'll go to dust, just like the tree and everything else, because they're just another part of creation that is of nature down here. Not created in the image of God. If your animal dies, you say they go to heaven. Well, the only way they could would be if God recreated them up there with them. They're of this world and they're not spirit eternal beings. When they die, they die. We are born of water. We're born of the Spirit. We're created in the image of God. We are eternal beings who can never cease to exist. Their existence is contained and limited to this world. So if they go to heaven, as far as I know, it can't be until the end. because they are not spirit beings. Someone has said that dogs seem to have a soul, given that they have such characteristics of care and companionship as they do. But that doesn't mean they have a soul, that just means they have better instincts than other animals. Animals are instinct driven. And the evidence of that is that certain dogs, being all of the canine family, differ in instinct. And some of that depends on how they're raised and such and so on. But there are different genres of instincts. I mean, some dogs will mess you up. Some dogs, you don't want to go around them. They will tear you up, even their owner, they'll tear up, and they don't care. Their instincts are not care. They don't care. Other dogs, though, are so kind, so tender, so caring. Even cats, I guess, and other kinds of animals. But they are instinct-driven animals. It's not so much that they are spirit beings or they have a soul. It's just that they have certain instincts, and those instincts are better than other animals. So God has given them to be a companion to us. And their instincts differ in genre per breed of that particular breed of animal. Understand? But that doesn't mean they have a soul. That just means that some dogs, most dogs, I think a lot of dogs, have instincts to nurture, to kind, to protect, to be a companion. That doesn't indicate they have a soul. That just indicates that they have emotion by instinct. It's in their instinct. It's in their DNA to care, to protect, to be a friend. There's no indication that they're a spirit being. No animal is a spirit being. They can be possessed by spirits. We know that from the gospel. We know that from the word of God. Jesus cast out the demons from the man. They went into the pigs. The pigs went crazy. They can be possessed by spirit beings and be a house for a spirit, just as every body can, and just as our body houses our spirit and is the vehicle of our spirit. But they themselves are not spirit beings. They are just flesh and blood. As the same with the insects, with everything else. However, God preserveth man and beast. And if they are to make it to heaven, if your animal is to make it to heaven, if your pet, your livestock, whatever, if that deer that God seems to favor, whatever it be, a horse, a cow, a bear, whatever it be, a beast that has found favor in the eyes of God, and He wants to bring them to eternal life, if God's going to do that, how will He do it? I believe He'll do it. Just like He did it in the days of Noah and Jonah. He'll do it through the covenant. He'll do it through the human being that has been redeemed. What were the animals that survived in the days of Jonah and the days of Noah? They were the animals that were in the covenant with those who were redeemed. I talked about how there could be a mysterious statement that Paul made, how the unbelieving husband, the unbelieving child, can be considered somehow redeemed by the believing soul, and that somehow it seems in the New Covenant there's some way, somehow, that those you are related to can somehow be brought to heaven with you. Don't take my word for that. Don't take your chances. Because Paul said, I don't know everything about that. And Paul said, later on in that same chapter, he said, who knows whether or not you, believing wife, will save your unbelieving husband, or you, believing husband, will save your unbelieving wife. He said, who knows? In other words, he's saying there is a chance. So you're telling me there's a chance. There's a chance, but it's a mystery. And we don't know how God's going to judge that. So if you're a son or a daughter of a mother or a grandmother who prayed and prayed and prayed for you, who loves God, but you don't love God yourself, you're taking your chances. And who knows how God's going to call it? What judgment call is He going to make? We don't know. Who knows? If you find mercy, it'll probably be by ignorance through relation. But you're taking your chances and you're gambling your eternal soul if you think that. I say, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. You must, as an individual, make a decision for Jesus Christ yourself. If you are going to try to bank on the faith of somebody else, you are taking your chances. And odds are, in my opinion, that you're going to hell. Because you must be born again. It's an individual matter, and I don't know how God's going to call that. That's a mysterious statement I don't have full revelation of, but it was given by Him to whom the revelation of the New Covenant was given. Well, you better not take your chances. You had better not take your chances. But he preserves man and beast, and how's he going to do it? I don't think it could happen here. I don't think if our pets die now, they can go to heaven automatically. That's, in my opinion, I don't find evidence of that in the Bible. But what I do find evidence of is that God saved the animals in the days of Noah. He saved those under judgment, potentially, that he would eradicate and make extinct in the time of Jonah. And he did it by those who repented and by those who trusted in his covenant and were in his covenant. Therefore, if your pet, so to speak, is lucky enough, fortunate enough to find a home that is redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, to get in the ark with Noah, the ark covered by the blood, the ark of the covenant, although not the ark of the covenant, you understand what I'm saying, the covenant of the rainbow, if they're fortunate enough to find themselves in that lottery win where they end up in a safe place under the blood of Christ some way, somehow, they then are eligible by relation to you, and that you love them, and God loves you more than anything else, and he wants you to be happy, and he wants you to have what you love in eternity, if it's righteous, if it's holy, and he himself even loves and considers the creature, then he, by the blood of his son, in that it is related to you, can bring them up to heaven, just as he did in the days of Noah, just as he did in the days of Jonah. God can do it, but he'll do it, I believe, by bringing them back up. He has our members written in a book, and I'm sure he has the members of every creature he's ever created written in a book. And he can recreate them in the blink of an eye. He knows who they are. He knows where they are. And when we get to heaven in the end, after the resurrection, I believe I'm going to see my dearly beloved pets that I've lost. And I believe you will too, if you're trusting in Christ. If you're not, you're not going to make it to heaven yourself, so why would God bring them up there anyways, even though he cares for them? But because he cares for you and he cares for them, he's going to bring many of them up. There are creatures in heaven that are beyond our imagination that make the animal kingdom here look like God did not expend any creativity upon him when he created it. Because they're so amazing, so astounding, so unbelievable. You're going to be amazed when you get to heaven and you see some of the creatures that God has created that he wouldn't let come to this earth, that didn't come to this earth, that were not on this earth, because they're of a heavenly realm. You're going to be friends with them. The lion shall lay down by the lamb. God's going to change the nature and the instinct of the animal in the end. And many of the animals, the same animals that were here before, will be brought back in that end time after the resurrection. And they will live forever and ever, because they will not be under the curse, and they will somehow have found favor in God's eyes. Maybe that animal defied their instinct and protected a human being, I don't know. But certainly those who were found some way, somehow, related underneath and in the covenant of Christ, in the ark, in the city that repented, Nineveh, you can bank on it. He preserves man and beast. They will be there in the end. That dearly beloved pet that you lost, can you count on seeing them in heaven? Yes, I believe so. I believe God will bring them up, back up there, recreate them. Are they there right now? I don't think so. I don't see how that's possible. They are not spirit beings. I don't see how in the world that's possible. When we die, we leave our body because we're spirit beings. When they die, they just go back to the dust. They're physical beings, natural beings. But God's going to bring them back, and many of them will find his favor by the covenant and just that he cares for them. They're not responsible for sin, even though they are impacted by it greatly, and they suffer from it greatly. But his eye is on the sparrow, and he cares for them. Yes, our animals, I believe, our dearly beloved pets will be in heaven. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that's confirmed by my spirit within me. I believe that's confirmed by this word. He preserves man and beast. He cares for them too. He provides for them too. They're his creation too. Jesus, he didn't primarily die for them. They were not the immediate individuals on his mind or creation on his mind. But contained in his precious blood is provision even for those creatures that he created, because he cares for them too. And there is a way for them to make it to heaven also. That way is the same way for us, the blood of Christ. They don't have to believe. They can't be regenerated. They can't be redeemed by their faith. They all know there's a God. Yes, they do. And many of them are observant of the spiritual realm. And they can see it. You see your dog barking at a wall. He's probably looking face to face with a demon spirit, looking it right in the eyes. They can see it, many of them. They have senses we don't have. They have senses we don't have. You should know that if you hang around them. But God preserves man and beast, and I believe with all my heart that I'm going to see those animals that I loved again in eternity. Again, I'm not foolish. I don't have a carnal perspective of animals as much as I love them. I don't have a sinful view of them. I have a biblical view. But I love them, and I thank God for His goodness that has even preserved those that we care so much about and those that He cares so much about, our animals, our pets. I believe you can rest assured you're going to see your animal again one day in heaven, your pet one day. And we'll see many others that we're here that God will bring up in that end time. What does all this say to us? How can I conclude this? Well, what I can say is if He cares so much about the animals, how much more does He care for you and me? His eye is on the sparrow, the song says, and I know He watches me. The Bible says, Jesus said that not one sparrow will fall to the ground, but that God knows, and that God provides for them. And if He cares so much about the animals, if He cares so much about them, if He has even provided for their salvation, how much more, my friend, does He care for you and me? You are God's primary concern. You are the love of God's heart, the apple of His eye, not the animal. He cares for them and He loves them, but nowhere near as much as He loves you. And if you consider how much He cares for the animal, and how He's even provided for them, you can understand just how much more He cares for you who was created in His image. God loves you, and He loves you so much. You are God's priority. You are God's primary concern. You are God's obsession in His heart. He loves you. And you can understand in that how much He cares for the animals, that He's given them even to you, to provide for your natural strength, to even cover for your sin in the old way. If He has given those who He cares so much about you, what a gift. You've seen how much He's expended. And then the fact that He gave His only begotten Son. How much more does He care for you, and how much does He care for you? In that you can gauge and gain a revelation of the capacity of God's love for you. How great, how deep the Father's love for you. Oh, how He loves you and me. Oh, how He loves you and me. He gave His life. He gave His life. Oh, how He loves you. Oh, how He loves you and me. God loves you, my friend. And when He gave His best, He didn't give an animal. He gave His best. He gave Himself to die on the cross for you. If He cares about the sparrow, how much more does He care for you and me? And how much more will He provide for our needs according to His riches and glory? If you take one thing away from this, take away that God loves you. If He has made a way for your pet to get into heaven, if He saved those many, many animals in Jonah's day in the city of Nineveh, if He saved those many animals in Noah's day, should we be concerned about extinction? I guess in certain cases, maybe we can do something about that. But God's eye is on the sparrow. And He's the one who is their master and their caretaker. And if they go extinct, or it's His will, I suppose. But know that God has made a place even for your pets. He cares about you that much that He wants them up there in heaven with you. And He even cares for them. And if He cares for them, understand He cares for you so much more. Gain a revelation today about how much God loves you. Gain a new understanding about how much He loves you. He loves you. He died for you. He gave His best for you. You mean so much more to Him than anybody else, than anything else, any other creature. Jesus died on the cross for you. Understand that today. His eyes on the sparrow. And if He cares for the sparrow, He cares so much for you. God loves you so much. Put your trust in Him. Put your trust in His blood that you may be there in heaven with Him in the end. And that your pets do it. I mean, if for nothing else, do it for your pets. So they can live forever too. You and I are eternal beings. Do it for yourself above all because you're going to live in heaven or hell forever. Trust in Jesus Christ. He died for you. Believe in Him and don't wait. We're not promised tomorrow He could come. Now trust in Him right now. He'll take your sin away. He'll wipe your sin away. He'll make you a brand new person. He'll give you a new heart. He'll redeem you. You mean so much more to Him than the animals. He loves you. He died for you. Believe in Him. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know He watches me.
And I sing because I'm happy. The path He leadeth, but one step I may see. Oh, His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Watching me.